Okay, funnel. Beautiful. Big, big funnel right in the middle. Big funnel right in the middle.
Find a way of getting over there.
We're going to go back up to the hill that Howie and them were on earlier. It's just a little up the road here.
Okay, it's coming down.
It's coming down. Yeah, you can get some. Very nice funnel. Hey, nice going. It's going to be a big tornado. Yeah, let's just stop. We're going to have to stop. There they are. They're already photographing.
It's the only one they had. And I'm not sure if it's ever going to be a collector's item, but I thought it was great.
David, you're credited as being the first known storm chaser in modern history.
Yes.
Where did it all begin for you?
Okay, I was just out of high school, and it was the summer of 1956 in June. And I went down to a local movie theater for an early evening show. And the storm had not yet started, but it was gathering just to the west of the city. And I looked at that briefly, and then I went inside. And you could hear the thunder outside very loud, right over the theater. So after half an hour, my father came down the aisle to the theater. And he said I should come outside. There was a better show. The storm had gone through the city and really torn it up. We came around one corner. And there were some power lines laying in the wet grass, and they were jumping and sparking with the water. And that just blew me away. I was just really fascinated. Wind, you fly a kite on, or you sail a boat on, big deal, you know, big whoop. It was a turning point in my young life, and I thought, I've got to learn more about this stuff.
It goes so far back that I can't tell you when it started. It's been as long as I can remember, and my parents confirmed that 1, 2, 3 years old, standing at the back porch watching it rain. Third word was Wayne, I think, according to my mom.
Dad pulled down the T volume and turned to this page with a couple of plates of tornadoes, and I was fascinated. So I think there are certain things that happen with passions in our lives where there are these signal moments.
Former is often referred to as curvature vorticity.
8 or 9 was the time I remember looking at storms. I remember seeing the bases of thunderstorms and seeing the lightning and being enthralled. I think a lot of people around that 3rd, 4th grade level start to really, in their mind, think, I love this, or I'm passionate about something.
In the West, through the Great Lakes.
Howie Bluestein had just started teaching there my sophomore year. He walked in one day and just said, they're thinking about having some chase people go out and take pictures of storms. Anybody in here interested? And walked around. Yep, I'll do it.
A long time ago, I talked about people dedicating their life to chasing. There's a good percentage of people that have become so consumed with it that they've let the rest of their life fall aside.
After a while of not getting any storms, it's kind of odd, but I actually do get a little bit depressed.
They have the characters. You've got the person that's filming, which could be any of them.
Get in!
Then you've got the alpha who's, you know.
Drive!
I just drove you in the middle of a tornado, but calm down, please.
It sucks!
You run into the moral conundrum.
Right.
Our being there does not affect whether or not the event is going to happen.
Right.
These are natural phenomena.
Oh my God! Did you see that?
The more video there is out there, the more saturated the market's getting, so it's becoming harder and harder to be able to finance yourself that way.
Ah.
For me, this has always been my dream. This has been what I've always wanted to do. So for me, is it sustainable? Yes.
Now we can watch it live as it happens. So there's no more anticipation. That's something that I think has gotten lost, and that was something that I do miss about storm chasing, was the anticipation, getting the tape and all that stuff, and that's gone. Now it's instant gratification. It's like we can see these events as they happen, but that also makes you feel more like, oh, look at what I'm missing.
You're putting so many more people out there. There's gonna be risks where there's really violent tornadic storms in places where there's few roads and way too many people and there's no way to get out of the way.
I don't see it changing. And I don't believe that the Twist X guys are the last chasers that are going to be killed in the act of chasing, period.
We'll be right back.
David, who was Roger Jensen?
Roger Jensen was a farmer who lived near Moorhead, Minnesota, right across from Fargo. And he started in 1953. He basically took photographs from his father's farm, or his father and he may have driven short distances where he could take pictures.
It was only later that he began to get a bit of a reputation as a storm enthusiast. He wasn't the chaser the way we think of chasers these days. He was really a sky photographer who was a weather nut.
I'd seen some of his photography on the covers of Weatherwise, the old magazine.
But you could tell the guy was just steeped in weather and clouds.
He could get on your nerves a little bit because he was a single track of thought. And I can well imagine you being like that.
Yeah. Well, I have a few other interests.
These films by WDAY photographer Harry Jennings were taken about 7:30 as the tornado boiled toward Fargo out of the west.
Storm sign spotted here. Turbulent formations were observed to the east of Bismarck by a local amateur cloud watcher, David Hoadley, 522 Avenue D, pursuing a hobby he has been following the past 2 years. Just getting started. Give me time. So I was a cloud watcher. There's a distinction. In the early days when we were all amateurs, it was cloud watching. When we became more experienced, we were dignified by the term storm chaser. First photograph I made, August of 1958, and it was near Wing, North Dakota, which is about 30 miles northeast of Bismarck. At the time I took the series of pictures that led up to this, I wasn't sure that that's what I was seeing, but I decided later on that the indications were pretty definite that it was tornadic.
Neil, this is your latest model.
A lot of people did not believe that there was any point in trying to chase a tornado. In 1961, he proved them wrong. So he made a deal with the Oklahoma Highway Patrol to use a radio car to communicate with the radar people. The radar people saw a hole in the updraft. He headed for that hole in the supercell, and at Geary, Oklahoma, became the first person to scientifically track down a tornado. I consider that to be the first true tornado chase.
Between then and my next tornado, I didn't see anything for 3 or 4 years.
The July 1962 tornado was unusual because of this carrying aloft and smashing to the ground of a herd of heavy cattle. And that had to be a serious tornado with a lot of updraft to do that. They're not aerodynamic, despite what Twister showed.
May 25th, 1965. I got a picture of a small tornado near Mineola, a little ropey one, and then I drove further east and I stopped on the west side of Pratt. It was kind of rolling thunder overhead. Otherwise, there was hardly any rain, and then out of this storm base, almost like a painter painting a canvas, came this perfectly symmetrical vortex, came down. And I had a new camera at that time. It was a Mamiya Flex. It took 2.25-inch film. My hands were shaking. I knew I was shaking. I was trying to hold it. I had no tripod. It was a case where you can't control yourself. So I had the presence of mind to put the camera down the hood of my car for this one picture. I got this one good picture that day. I saw pictures of that in the newspaper, and I felt very badly to miss that. Whether or not I would have been there anyway, did not chase at all, because I was saving annual leave for my anticipated honeymoon the next year.
I must have learned about it fairly soon after we met, because I don't remember ever not knowing about it.
Nancy wanted to see what chasing was like, so she flew out probably to Wichita, and I picked her up.
I didn't have a driving interest to see a tornado.
We spent a weekend there because she was still working, and I had taken annual leave to take a week or two off.
The first thing I noticed when he picked me up at the airport was that he was looking at the sky instead of the road. So I said, well, I'll drive.
In one particular day, it was very hot and dry, and I was trying to decide whether I wanted to be in one place or the other.
I swear that I went through one little town back and forth, I'm thinking at least 8 times.
I think she's exaggerating. It was 3 times. It was dusty. It was hot.
And I thought, there's got to be something more than this storm chasing, because this is crazy.
We were, I think it was Quanta, Texas. We stopped on 287 to get something to drink.
Then we're reading paperback books, waiting for something to happen when you heard on the radio.
In Lubbock, they were having four or five large tornadoes.
So I just said, there's just really not much percentage in this hobby. I don't think I'll be participating in this.
So she flew back home, and this is certainly the kind of dedication that only a spouse could make who was wanting to find out and learn what it was that drove me.
This is the National Severe Storms Laboratory in Norman, Oklahoma. It's the only weather facility in the country specializing in the study of tornadoes.
70s were a time for NSSL and others to make leapfrog discoveries. They started looking at it seriously in 72, sending chasers out in the field for the first time, government-sponsored, to have people call back if they had early cell phones, or call on a local telephone and say, here's what we're looking at.
It wasn't really a prolific year for him collecting data. About 1 o'clock, the phone rings. And I just ignored it. And so the phone rings again. And I pick it up, and it's Al Mohler. But he said, Randy, get your out of bed. Central Oklahoma's going to blow up in tornadoes. And he said, get down here. 5 minutes. You got 5 minutes. It was like a mile and a half, and so I had my camera equipment by the doors, and I run in a sprint down to the meteorology department. I was dead. I was out of breath. I was gasping for breath, and there was Al standing there. Where have you been? Where have you been?
We went off in my Mustang, headed up west on I-40, got up near Geary, and there were it was a storm back up in that area.
But the OU team wasn't sure, and I think they could quickly see that it was probably going to come squall line, so they retreated back.
At that time, saw a couple of cold air or funnels that was in the outflow air, and so we stopped and took pictures of those, and then headed south on Highway 81. It was headed right towards Union City, and at that point we didn't know what we were doing.
And then we made the plunge into the core. Of course, visibility went down to damn near zero, and we're getting hail. Lots of precip, raining like crazy, couldn't see squat. And Al was sitting in the shotgun seat, and all of a sudden he says, hey, what's that? And it's almost completely invisible.
The tornado was now east of Union City, but ahead of us was just nothing but rubble.
It was surreal. I mean, gas lines were hissing, power lines were across the road.
Once we got the calls from the chase teams, that's when we'd call the weather service and let them know. And then the tornado was visible to the northwest from the roof of the NSSL building.
I walked down to the next recognizable street corner, kind of walked over the rubble. And there was still a standing building. It was a stucco building, apparently a gas station. A man and a woman and a young child, maybe 10 years old, a little girl, pop out of a storm cellar. The look on this lady's face was one of just absolute shock and horror, like she could not comprehend what she was looking at. I was observing this. I was standing 15 yards away, kind of like an interloper. It had a terribly important, humbling, emotional effect on me. I had never prepared myself for that. To me, it was just point, point, click, click, it's over. You leave, you pack up your gear, you leave town, and that's it. At that moment, for the first time, I just couldn't, I really realized that there's a human side to storm chasing, that these storms do have an after effect, that they do really affect people in real ways. There were tears streaming down my cheeks. I was holding back tears. So I just turned around and walked away to the car.
It was a most unusual day.
During the meeting, Ed Pearl, one of our staff meteorologists, ran in. Sorry to interrupt, but you probably want to see this. There's rotating cloud going right over top of the building.
The day of the killer tornadoes.
So, of course, we all ran up to the roof, exactly the opposite of what anybody should do. Dr. Fujita had his wife collect up some of the hailstones. Later on that evening, he had a cocktail on the hailstones.
Right after the storm, this is a great force, my student and I flew over.
By the afternoon of the 4th, it became pretty obvious that we had tornadoes all the way from Illinois to Mississippi, and it was going to take quite a team effort to survey those as quickly as possible before people started really cleaning up the damage. The Fujita planes would all be Cessnas, high-winged Cessnas, so we could look out the window, bank, take photographs, map, etc., and we'd sort of spiral our way up and down the pass.
Fujita spends most of it shuttling around the country in a Learjet chasing tornadoes and their aftermath. Fujita and his people have studied and documented thousands of twisters. The sheer volume of information he's accumulated over the last 24 years is incredible.
Fujita was as much an artist as a scientist. Everything about him was how I envisioned the Wizard of Oz would be.
Okay, let's go. It's already going up.
When severe weather threatens, the whole place swings into action. Chase teams and automobiles take to the fields with photographic equipment, while the men at the Doppler radar gather data on cloud formations.
It wasn't well known back in the 70s and became known over time.
Most of them are on call 24 hours a day during the peak thunderstorm and tornado period.
The stars were aligned for the beginning of not just intense Doppler radar collection, but the close interaction of the Doppler program and storm intercept.
In the 1970s, there was nothing calm about me. I was considered kind of number one on the list to get killed.
You know? Storm chasing right from the very beginning. It was very clear that every chaser had a unique personality.
I was an example of probably the worst chaser.
He did get in very, very close. I was one of the few people at NSSL that worked with him regularly because I didn't see him as a rogue, or not a rogue, but a... you know, kind of taking too many chances.
I wasn't trying to show off. I just thought it was neat. I mean, being in the wall cloud, especially if it reached the ground, the condensation just boils off the ground like smoke. I mean, watching those things is just outrageous. You can't see that from 10 miles away.
But I don't think that he took the chances that I'm seeing on some of the TV shows and on YouTube these days.
I set aside about 3 weeks in May. I go out to Oklahoma and Texas and chase tornadoes.
I knew Jim Leonard well, and he was around our program.
I don't know if we're going to get out of the way of it.
Jim was a very affable, friendly person, very tenacious. It was only those that were really dedicated and persistent that... were successful and maybe enjoyed it the most, and Jim Leonard was definitely one of those people.
Randy, how did Storm Track begin?
I was either invited out or Dave and I decided to go out to the AMS Severe Storms Conference, which was in Omaha. Dave had taken a bunch of slides, a presentation of his best pictures. He had such an overwhelming response. Dave decided that there's got to be a way that storm chasers can communicate.
I thought about doing a newsletter, and Randy Zipser was there, and we shared the room, so we sat down and we exchanged ideas. This was the beginning of Storm Track. When I got back home in a month or so, I had developed the first Storm Track.
I asked him, how did you come up with the name Storm Track? And he just said, Star Trek. Those were his only words to me, Star Trek. Star Trek, Storm Track. There was the name play.
Some people call him the grandfather of storm chasing because he was labeled that in an article. I don't think of him that way. What I think of him is being is the guy that showed up and facilitated kind of the social agglomeration, if you will, of the chase community.
This series presents information based in part on theory and conjecture.
I don't know what impression other people had of it, but I never met Nimoy.
The tornado is the fiercest of all storms.
I remember being struck with the efforts of the production crew to make a past episode, which had just recently happened, look real. Anyway, when they were shooting In Search Of, in terms of trying to recreate that scene in the weather, and we reshot that scene over 30 times.
Okay, John, I copy.
So that they could get it looking dramatic enough.
They watch with mounting interest.
Okay, John, what do you see?
I was sitting at my desk, and the room was very small, and Brad had to come in and fall down to a knee outside of shot.
I've just been up on the observation deck, and there's a big new set of towers building into the southwest side of that El Reno.
Okay, store. Thank you, Brad.
And I got so punchy at one point that he came up close to me and said, John, John, and I went, I love you, Brad.
Don't miss Donahue.
He's a technical services director for a chemical company, which he says requires a great deal of traveling. Here, riding the storm out, is contestant number one, Tim Robinson.
Right in the storm.
Lake 9, KWTV, Oklahoma City.
It ain't coming this way.
We sent out our photographers. We sent out our reporters. We sent out anybody that we could get in a vehicle with a camera. Well, we determined that, you know, if we sent them to Woodward, they were at some sale, they were, you know, shopping for stuff. And so I had to switch to, for every tornado you get a case of beer.
Oh, shit, Bill.
What?
I clearly remember May 17th and May 81. Very exciting videos being collected.
Rain or hail curtains wrapping extremely rapidly right at 11:30, right ahead of us, and very dark ahead.
Eric was using his significant knowledge of cloud forms and structures to know that all this was going on.
Rapid circulation right overhead. Slow down, Neil. Stop. Rapid circulation. About one half. Debris. Tornado passing right in front of us.
As soon as they saw that tornado, then they communicated that back to us.
Coming right at us. I got it on video. Tracking it on video. Funnel passed right in front of us. Split in screen. Can hear thunder.
Listen to it roar. Sounds like a waterfall.
No one get a tape recorder.
Stay! Bring the tape recorder!
The official forecast for that day was no storms.
It was LP to start with. Big storm. Hell of an updraft going up. Big wall cloud. Big tornado.
There it goes. There's another touching spot. Yeah.
So what they do? They fly over there. And they get caught in the inflow. You never heard so much hollering and screaming in your life. At first it was like, joy, we're doing this. Then it turned into blood-curdling screams. Because I talked to the pilot later. He said, God, he's about 10 more seconds. We'd been gone.
We're going slowly towards it.
Colgate was an entrepreneur.
The bigger storm was the first one in which he was in terrible turbulence and maybe danger of losing control of the aircraft.
Note the bright, flare-like object seen hurtling towards the tornado. This was a tornado rocket probe. You can see the aircraft that launched the rocket turn away from the tornado to the left.
He did some checking, and he found that the FAA guidelines were pretty liberal for toy rockets.
A lot of it he did just flying in the seat of his pants, flying by himself, and trying to do everything. The coordination and the flying and the arming and the shooting of the rockets.
He devised a wing rack for these rockets, and I think he could put two or three on each wing, and he could fire them from the inside of the plane.
And do we supposedly have everything booted?
And I warned him two things. I said, you better not get too close. If you see a tornado, there's going to be a lot of lightning activity nearby, and there could be hail and heavy rain nearby. He said, I'll be careful.
Get in just a little closer this time.
Long story short, he didn't get any useful data. He had a number of close calls where he would fire the rockets and they'd either go to the right or go to the left of the funnel, even from close range.
Fire. There.
I met Kay at a Chuck Mangione concert. I decided to take her out on a chase. I mean, that's how you get to know women, right? So the first chase we went on was May 9 of 1982, Dawn, Texas. We actually met Rasmussen. He had a date. We double dated. And it was like 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock. Meanwhile, our dates are kind of getting like, you know, is this what storm chasing is like? And I was, no, it's really exciting. It was late. I mean, storms didn't fire till like 7 o'clock. Then at 8 o'clock, the Dawn tornado formed.
Right by the sun, honey.
The sun, for just a brief moment, comes out on the horizon and illuminates the tornado a brilliant orange.
Here it comes! It's coming down!
Woohoo!
Go, baby!
Woo! We got it!
She filmed it. I photographed it. Tornado was there and gone. And she turned to me at the very end of filming, just 58 seconds, and said, quote, hot damn, that was fun, unquote. And I said, there you go. There's my wife.
I need it.
The Weather Channel.
To watch the weather all day through. You need us.
The Weather Channel.
For everything you do.
homogeneous, and I can say that on cable TV.
We went on the air in May.
Still lots of Gulf moisture.
Yeah, I worked for the Weather Channel for the first 10 years the Weather Channel existed.
We were doing all weather.
Showers and thunderstorms depict the same thing.
Coming up this half hour on the...
But here's what happened in Wichita. Oh, that's actually Dennis Smith. But here's what's happening in Wichita earlier.
You know, we pleaded with them to do storm chasing, cover severe weather. I mean, not just at the Weather Channel, but out in the field.
We have a thermometer and a Durotherm here with us to give us a relative humidity.
It took a long time for the Weather Channel to do that transition.
This place has a way of making us think about...
If you don't know what you're doing, I wouldn't go out there because you might get yourself in a lot of trouble.
You know, check the satellite pictures, the upper air charts, and...
It was a massive tornado outbreak day. Everybody was in a frenzy, and the map room was filled with people. So everybody was excited by the day. And I remember Chris being in the map room.
He had asked me if he can go chasing with me, and I said I already had a couple people going with me. And I really beat myself up for that afterwards.
He and the girl, who I didn't particularly care for, and another friend of theirs, went chasing in Logan County. He'd never gone out on a storm chase. And apparently the story that the girlfriend gave was that he tried to avoid an animal on the road and drove off the road. His life ended tragically at 21 years of age. Lou, me, and almost everyone was in the map room. Lou called the State Highway Patrol. It took a minute or so. And Lou just hung up the phone and just said one word, dead. We were in shock. We'd lost a chaser, and he was a friend of mine. And we all looked at each other with this amount of disbelief. This could be any of us. I mean, it was 1984. But something was changing.
The Totable Tornado Observatory. Affectionately nicknamed Toto.
I've got, you know, this important project, first of its kind of thing, and I get a chance to, you know, sort of live the dream in some respects.
Lance, need to get both Nestle 2 cameras out of the silver case back there.
Okay, we're a couple of miles
It's a very exciting time. It's a very challenging time. Howie had moved on to doing some ballooning by then. And so I guess the lab took on Toto.
This is Toto, a 500-pound bundle of instruments that can measure temperature, winds, humidities, and atmospheric pressure.
Hopefully the tornado will pass right over Toto. Never happened so far. Tornado always seems at last minute just to change direction enough to miss it.
Watch the lightning, folks. Okay, deploy. Let's go. I got the thing. Deploy.
Yeah, I was kind of over the top, and it's good. It's good for the camera. I'm not sure it was great for my tracing partners.
Deep down. That's gonna be a classic.
For you kids at home, those were professional tornado tamers. Don't try that over the weekend. Just enjoy the weather and have a nice holiday.
It was never crazy during the 80s.
I see something going up. There it is.
87 and 88 were the lightest tornado years on record in Oklahoma.
Give me a tornado, any tornado.
NEXRAD is a new generation of weather radars designed to replace our aging network of weather radars.
NEXRAD will be tested in Norman in the spring of 1989.
CompuServe combines the power of your computer with the convenience of your telephone.
The primitive internet, or at least sort of an internet, was sort of showing up in the late 1980s.
Closest thing we started getting data over the phone was the acoustic coupler. We could get that raw data.
Absent that, you had to go to a weather service office. So we were really tethered to weather service offices.
This is a particularly dangerous situation.
This is where we're expecting the strongest storms.
It really looked volatile. We got an early start.
We left from the severe storms lab around noon or so.
We were able to watch the Weather Channel. We were able to see where the echoes were developing, and there were several of them.
The radar reports we were hearing from the NOAA weather radio was that there was a tornado. So I said, well, we don't want to stay here. We're right in the path.
The TV station said there's another storm to southwest. Well, perfect.
So we backtracked and crossed over from a point west of I-35 to a point east of I-35 and headed south.
There was a decent storm. The anvil edge was sharp as a tack.
Still a very large tornado.
The base came into view with a tornado already in progress.
We are at mile marker 203, close to I-35.
The car hadn't been acting all that well.
About time I saw one fully on the ground in the daylight.
Stalled.
Oh, God, geez.
It stalls.
Well, this could be a problem. It's kind of heading northeastward towards us.
Yep.
Hurry. Herb is going at 80 miles an hour. We're both videoing. That's where we ran into Bobby Prentice and Gene Roden with the hood of their car.
I still remember Herb rolling down the window and say, hey guys, you might want to think about moving.
You'd be smart to move a little bit. Hey, we're broke down.
Oh, that's too bad. Oh gosh, I hope they're gonna be okay. Keep going. The tornado's wedging out at this point.
Yeah, how much time are we gonna have on this?
About, Jeff, 5 minutes.
That's pretty close.
Let's get it quickly.
Oh, no, we can stay here for a little while longer.
The right mover, we better go south. It's coming right at us.
And then I realized that, oh my word, the tornado wasn't changing in azimuth, it was just getting wider and wider and wider.
We better move south.
We had actually broken down in the road, so I actually convinced the guys that we actually need to push the car off the road.
At that point, we began to realize it was due south of us, and it was just trucking east.
As the tornado was about to cross I-35, we were able to get the car started and drive south.
Let's get the hell out of here.
And the wind at this point, we're in the inflow.
Just concentrate on the radar.
Put the radar on. The pedestal. I'm holding it, and if I didn't hold on to it, in fact, I let go, and it was about to go like this. At this point, there's a loud audible roar from the tornado. We could see a roof get picked up by the tornado from a house up the highway, and it's rotating around the tornado and not falling. It went around 1.5, 2 times.
About 1 mile down the road, there was a telephone pole lying in the middle of the road, at which point I realized, good heavens, you don't have to be in the tornado to be in danger. There was a telephone pole flung outside the tornado.
We have a successful deployment. We got the data. We wanted to see what the peak wind speeds were.
When Wes Unruh analyzed the data, we found F5 wind speeds.
The twister struck mainly near Wichita.
Get up under the girders. Is that where you want to go? Yes.
Okay. Damn, we're that close?
Yes, we are that close.
The first time that I saw it go really crazy was in 1991 near Wichita, Kansas.
Tornado's still there.
The storm chasing community is growing at a steady pace. Media interest is increasing.
Most of us run from tornadoes.
Very nice wall cloud, and the whole thing is rotating.
Others can't get close enough.
And you think you're the only ones there, and it looks like it's about ready to tornado, and suddenly there's 20 vehicles.
Tornado watch issued at 1:22.
No matter how careful you are, sometimes you do find yourself being chased by what you were pursuing.
I filmed it coming across the lake from the west side here.
Oh, power lines, I'm getting every power line out.
This is cool.
My trusty radar tells me there's a line of tornadoes forming in the Western County region.
Whoa. We're there, dude.
Yeah.
It was at that point that I realized this could go crazy.
Carson Eads, who redesigned and modified an Astrovan, he calls the Storm Trucker. Eads' portable tornado lab is complete with a television, video camera, cellular telephone, 3 radios, a scanner, and an antenna controller, a laptop computer, a monitor, and a printer.
We drop probes into the paths of tornadoes, trying to get an idea of what kind of force is contained within these vortices.
There are more chasers than ever this spring, and not all are amateurs. Many are part of a large government-funded project called Vortex.
This is by far the biggest project that's gone on, that's sole goal has been to look at tornadic storms.
The Vortex group hopes to be able to get out in at least 10 major severe weather events this spring.
Welcome to Storm Chasers Conference 1995.
The Weather Channel had a tornado chaser convention.
I got this strange idea. What I did was I developed a Storm Chaser homepage.
This was the first time that a lot of people got together.
After
Video Classics 1, 2, and 3 is done, and people have seen a lot of spectacular tornadoes. And after Universal Studios and Steven Spielberg and Michael Crichton are done with the American public, what's left to be done?
The media was very interested in tornado chasers and their footage, and the Weather Channel was on top of it.
After you had a wonderful, great forecast that got you right to the scene of that, we're going to get this the best we can back to the Weather Channel.
They wanted footage, and they wanted it cheap, and they wanted it fast.
They prowl the plains looking for twisters, seeking that adrenaline rush dedicated to the chase.
And at the same time, it's because I think they heard that in Hollywood, they're thinking about doing this movie.
Hi, Joey.
Hey, Bill.
Starting tomorrow, theaters all over the Kansas City area will premiere the movie Twister. And if the previews are any indication, Twister should do for tornadoes and spring storms what Jaws did for sharks and a swim in the ocean.
I first became aware of storm chasing because of Twister, most definitely.
As the talk turns to Twister, the movie, and Twister, the reality. Is the movie accurate?
Is the movie accurate?
Or does that matter? Does it matter? Is it just good fun and let's not take it as good science?
I think you should probably take it as a Hollywood movie.
A lot of people are going to watch this, and after the movie Twister, they're going to be out there trying to chase them, and some people are going to get themselves hurt.
Twister convinced the world that everybody could and should chase storms. School of Meteorology at OU, their attendance doubled in 1 year after Twister because everybody wanted to come and go to school at OU and get a career in storm chasing.
The extreme! It's the extreme!
I admired the adventure, I suppose, but a strong female, I liked that.
Why can't we spend a normal day together?
But it was the visual, the beauty of the visual of the tornadoes.
I was the only person in the theater laughing. And I probably got a bunch of funny looks, but I didn't care. I watched this and I went home and thought that was awful.
The movie was fun. To me, it was like storm comedy.
Folks, my next guest tonight is a United States postal worker. He's probably going to want to talk to you, Dennis. Mm-hmm. Who over the past 20 years has spent his spare time risking his life chasing tornadoes. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jack Thunderhead Corso.
Well, with the movie and now everybody has a video camera, everybody's going to be out there. Right. Oh, this looks easy.
Right.
But it's not.
It's not easy. So you think a lot of amateurs are out there saying, I'm going to do it too, and they drive out there, and then they could actually potentially get hurt.
I got a bunch of letters, mostly girls, 9 to 11, believing Helen Hunt was the role model. They wanted to become scientists. They wanted to become tornado chasers.
But in the next year or two, it seemed like the number of chasers or people calling themselves chasers that I'd never heard of exploded. That also coincided with the availability of the World Wide Web to the public.
So it was technology that changed the face of chasing. But I don't think technology is what separates chasers.
Aether, deadly force.
Get the brief hung out of the sky.
Ranger 9 confirms power flashes, Gary.
You're hot. We got you. You're hot.
Don't go down.
Wow. Yeah, May 3rd, 99 was insane.
Help! Come on, gather road.
And I didn't even know what I was looking at structurally back then. You know, in fact, the first 4 or 5 years I chased, because I kind of am self-taught, you know, and never went. I should have gone with veteran chasers that knew what they were doing, but I just let it rip.
Hang on, it's out of focus, hang on.
When my generation came in the mid-late 90s, the guys that had been around for 20 years then are like, God, now it's really crowded. But it's all perception, because today, I bet those guys that griped about us in the 90s would love to have those crowds back.
I was never searching for exposure. I was just out there storm chasing and having fun and seeing, you know, seeing tornadoes. And I was walking back to my dorm, and this guy came up to me and found out we had video through word of mouth in the dorms, and some guy, producer from Real TV, was with him. Took him up to the dorm. I popped in the video we took, showed it to him, and he was like, oh my God, you could see his eyes just get all big, and he's like, I'll give you $200 for it. And I'm like, of course, sure. Suddenly my dorm phone was ringing off the hook. Lisa Gibbons from Los Angeles called and asked if I could fly, wanted to be flied out there to do an interview.
Charles Edwards, RJ Evans, and Reed Timmer, welcome all of you. You love this, you know about it, you understand the anatomy of these storms, and yet you sound horrified.
Yeah, this is the first time I've actually ever felt my life in the hands of Mother Nature.
Let's listen to it.
Getting hit! I'm flying, you guys!
I had no idea back then that it was creating the extreme storm chasing.
Reed was a great self-marketer, you know, yeah. self-promoter. And you know, even when things really weren't that dangerous with him, you know, he made it sound like it was. You know, a lot of chasers resented him for it.
Before I say anything, I'd just like to acknowledge everybody who's with us who also risked their lives for this.
I think the storm chasing community is probably similar to surfing in a lot of ways, you know, and you get the more seasoned veterans that are allowed to surf the bigger waves and you kind of have to work your way up and gain the respect of them. But, you know, I said some stupid things when I look at the interviews, you know, it makes me cringe to watch some of them. So, I mean, they were right in a lot of ways, but I think that there are better ways to educate people that are new to a community to help out the community as a whole.
My whole point was not to push my career forward with chasing. It was to use chasing to become a better scientist. And if I became a better scientist, then I was serving my society. The people who were paying my salary were getting something for their money. And my salary was what supported my chasing, because I've had little or no sponsorship. But I felt an obligation to give something back. And that obligation, I think, is what separates responsible from irresponsible chasers.
And it was an awesome storm chasing evening for all of us here at News Center 16 and for the Valparaiso Kids.
Right around that time, I started noticing rotation.
What is this?
And every Tom, Dick, and Elmer will enjoy the spiky yellow ball of happiness today.
A tornado has ripped through North Texas.
All of this descended on the Dallas-Fort Worth area tonight.
Things really begin to change.
Several companies offer storm-chasing tours.
Wichita Falls is over here.
What's this idiot doing in my lane?
I had to learn to operate on two levels. I had my primary mission, which was really the safety, safe transportation in of the guests, and deal with issues that would come up that usually do when you bring people together and stuff them in a little space for days on end.
Why do you want to do this?
Love of weather, definitely. Just always love storms. The Midwest, it's so exciting. Lightning and tornadoes and hail.
And on the other hand, I still wanted to enjoy, because that's what they're out to do, I wanted to enjoy what we saw when we saw.
Lights just went out down there. They're gone. Lights. Are we going or what? No?
We took a tremendous risk on whether or not we were going to make this, they're going to get their money's worth, so to speak. They were, the tourists, taking tremendous risk, you know, on whether or not they get their money's worth. And it became a real fine line with stepping out of her own safety envelope. And then real long days.
Kenny, are you comfortable?
No.
The common point in the chase.
Das hier ist eine typische Situation während der Sturmjagd. My dad, he would, if there was a volcano erupting anywhere in the world, he'd grab a cameraman and go head off to, you know, Mexico, to Japan, to Indonesia, to Hawaii, and film volcanoes. That was his thing, volcanoes. My dad was a volcanoholic. He took the whole family, me included. And being on set, and I was on set a lot, 11-year-old, 12-year-old, so it was imprinted upon me at that age that, you know, that's a job, that's what you do in life, is that you go travel to somewhere exotic, you bring this large, unwieldy camera that's always breaking down, and you fight through the hand you're dealt to get the best possible shots you can.
Sean Casey was interested in filming tornadoes, and he knew we had the most active program doing that, so he contacted us, and he just wanted to follow us with a pickup truck.
It was like the prototype, really.
Yeah.
It was a pickup truck with a contractor rack in the back, some kind of area to shield you from the rain, and I had this helicopter armature thing that the IMAX camera was living on.
So they followed us around and got some pretty good footage.
We needed a armored vehicle that you could film from.
Sean and I talked about armoring up vehicles.
At first, when I saw the tornado tank, I said, well, somebody wants an elaborate way to kill themselves.
I heard the acronym COW for the TIV, Coffin on Wheels.
The idea was we would be able to work with him and tell him what the winds were.
He said, I'll decide what you can take, and I will guide you in, And if I feel like you can take it, I'll let you know. We were extremely close. There was a boat in the road. We stopped before the boat, and there was this farmstead that was completely leveled. So here we were, stuck in a ditch, canted a weird angle, mud slathered all over us at the scene of the, we were in ground zero. And people came upon us, and their first reaction was, we had been hit, of course.
Everybody okay here?
Tim Samaras came on scene. He had dropped a pod where we had deployed, where we got stuck. And he was extremely excited that this Manchester tornado had hit the pod.
We got two direct hits, you know, one down the road, and then one that was particularly violent.
He was always a very positive, upbeat guy. You know, he was always, you know, so high tech. You know, everybody wanted to be like Tim, you know, as far as their setups were, you know, in their vans or cars or whatever.
Tim's got almost every electronic device you could think of.
Years ago, I was actually able to mix my passion, which is storm chasing, along with my work. And my work is to design and build electronic gadgetry and instrumentation. That's certainly my first love. My other parallel love is storm chasing, so I was able to mix the two.
Meeting Tim, being living in Denver, I was exposed to him much more. You know, he'd be on the news stations, and he kind of was like, wow, this guy is really cool. So he was kind of like the pioneer, and I wanted to do what he was doing.
The storm is coming up on us, and it's part of the outflow.
Tim's an engineer like myself. We're both into building stuff. We're both into weather heavily. He's kind of what I aspire to be, because he took his engineering career, successfully combined it with weather, made a great living at it, made a name for himself, got respect. I would love all of those things for myself. And he is one of the nicest guys I've met. He actually personally helped me with several engineering projects related to chasing.
Okay, this is the first one's the Woonsocket tornado, so you can actually visualize the pressure drop.
You won't see direct references to data points that Tim collected, because in the long run, they didn't turn out to be as useful as they probably could have been. I think it's a shame. I think he really could have applied those his talents in a way which was more useful to the science, not just to chasing kind of as a recreational activity. And we certainly could have used some of the instruments that Tim did or could have developed, looking at tornado structure. I mean, we are using the data we got from resonance. We're using the data we got from the pods. We're using data from the TIV. And we have papers that use data from the TIV to really answer questions about tornado structure.
I'm glad to see that Sean and Reed and those other people who are doing tornado tanks are now being more measured.
Any project I do, I want to do my best. And I want to do things that haven't been done. I want to capture things in a new way.
We were discussing this with Discovery in 2005.
This was really cool for me because, you know, it's being on TV. It's a huge network show. And, you know, of course, when I found out I was going to be in it, you know, my parents were ecstatic.
Then they called us that January and said, hey, will you be on our show? And offered $12,000 flat rate.
Reality TV was paying the bills. It's kind of fun to be on the camera for a little while. But, you know, you don't realize at the time that, you know, it's always going to be there.
Doing the show itself was a lot of pressure because, you know, you do a storm chasing show, you think they're going to focus on chasing, but there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes.
They really wanted somebody doing those kind of scenes and going eek and screaming.
There was even talk about casting me a fake girlfriend for storm chasers.
I think it was clear to them that they needed more excitement in the show, and they also wanted more interpersonal conflict.
Well, I've never heard you use that word before.
She?
Yeah. I'm surprised you knew what it meant.
Why?
Chi?
You know, I'll watch some of these shows, and they're focusing obviously on the drama aspect of it. And in the beginning, Storm Chasers had a lot more science in it, and then that started to go away. What's not exciting? Like all of a sudden now, tornadoes aren't exciting enough. You know, and it ended up becoming like As the World Turns.
People like to see drama, and they like to see the character development. So I think a lot of the producers tried to bring that up, you know, whether it was forced or not.
He and Sean were willing to essentially ham it up and pretend to have battles. And we were not willing to do any of those. We wouldn't act out scenes where we were really fighting with Sean or we were really doing this.
It's aluminum.
Tinny.
It's aluminum.
They managed to cut and splice some things where it sort of looked like we had these disputes, but it isn't true. The fact is, I worked with Sean before Discovery Channel. I work with him after Discovery Channel's gone. I respect what he does.
He's a very determined guy.
I always look at the storm chasers as the best and possibly the worst thing that could have happened.
Yes! Yes!
There was really a lot of chasing for TV as opposed to chasing for chasing. And I think it really started to, you know, when you're out there doing this for 6, 7, 8 weeks at a time, you really get burnt out very, very quickly.
They'll show the footage totally out of sequence, and you know, they'll make like 5 chase days look like it all happened in one day and that your life was in danger and you were this close to death, and it's complete bullshit.
Just for this.
Nobody that was had the show with them when they were chasing got a tornado. Every tornado they had in the show was actually some video they bought from somebody else and just cut in. So I mean, it turned out just how I thought it was, called Rainy Road instead of Tornado Road.
It's about the ratings. So they're gonna hype up the drama as much as they can to get the ratings. We saw this happen with Discovery's Storm Chasers in the beginning. That show, and I don't blame the people that were on the show. I blame the producers of that show.
One man is doing it for cold hard cash.
We're in the tornado!
Oh, you see this?
The image of the storm chaser is probably as bad as it's ever been.
Look at this!
If I say this, it sounds totally sexist, but I think the reason is that the majority of storm chasers today are young guys who are trying to prove themselves. I don't think if the majority of storm chasers were teenage girls, or 20-ish girls, I don't think you'd see that.
I did an interview on CNN International. It went worldwide. I never once Facebooked or tweeted anything about doing the interview. I mean, when it comes down to it, it's about what happened, not about, hey, look what I did.
All of these guys, these outlaw chasers, yahoos and whatnot, it's all about them. And they sneer at the idea of giving something back and being responsible, avoiding creating hazards for somebody else.
Yeah, there it is, right there in front of us.
Oh, yeah. All right, we got one.
Yeah. Oh, that is beautiful.
You can get close to a tornado without hurting other people and hurting yourself. And as long as you're doing that, I don't give a damn what anybody says. They ain't gonna say anything to me. If the law ain't having to come fetch me or the morgue wagon, and I ain't killing nobody that's trying to get to shelter, and what the hell I'm doing is nobody's business but my own. This is America, still, barely.
Show at least some of the community that you are responsible, and there are a lot of storm chasers. In fact, I would say most of them are responsible.
But there's 1,000 of them out there. Now you literally could have 10 or 20 idiots in any around any given storm, and that's a lot of idiots when you're dealing with erratic driving and people that just show no respect for anything else, and frankly, some of them are just dumbasses that don't know what they're doing.
I'm not saying don't do it. I don't want to be a hypocrite and tell people don't do it because I do it.
Right.
But I try to do dangerous things in as safe a manner as possible. I'm concerned for other people's safety, but I also don't want people to be concerned about my safety and never have. And I think that as humans, you know, we're all intelligent, and who am I to judge somebody else's safety? I mean, that's kind of funny for me to say, oh, you're being unsafe, you know, you're jaywalking or something. I mean, that people just laugh at me. So, and I think that, you know, then you've got to go across the board and look at, well, are you going to show the Olympics on TV because that person might take up skiing and break their femur or something? Or, you know, are you going to show, on Animal Planet, something, a close-range video of lions, because everyone's going to try to start shooting close-range video of wildlife. And you could go across the board and just go nuts and not air anything on TV at all, too, you know. So, like, I think that always being concerned about other people's safety, it's kind of insulting when a bunch of other people are concerned about my safety, because I'm not an idiot. I know what I'm doing, you know, and at the same time. So I'm in no place to judge another person's safety. I just hope that they, you know, make the best decision for themselves, and that they were raised in such a way that, you know, when they're old enough to drive, that they can decide what's dangerous and what's not.
We're within a quarter mile of a monster tornado. That's all I can explain it.
Is getting the video so important? Is it worth your life? Is it worth your life to place yourself close to an intense tornado that you can't even see until it's on top of you?
Let go now!
What if the answer is yes?
Then I think those people have some serious psychological issues. And I think they should do themselves, their families, and the public a service by submitting themselves for therapy. Because there is something seriously wrong if you need to get video of a tornado so badly that it's worth your life. What ultimately is going to be accomplished by you getting that video? That's the question these chasers need to ask themselves.
Please, please, please don't let anybody hit us.
You're going to be able to say that you got the closest video? Well, you might not be able to say that because you might be dead.
Well, he's got a tornado behind him.
Yeah, Mike, can you hear us?
Guys, that's it. Right there. There's the tornado. We are just now, just north of Union City, south of El Reno, south of...
It's kind of one of those nasty, weird storms, and you think about how loose you can get with, you know, or how cavalier you can get with these kind of storms sometimes, because you've done it, you know, and it just takes one time for, you know, it to be slightly different.
El Reno right here, Mike Bettis right about in the path of the tornado.
I was reminded that you can be careful and sometimes still get into trouble, because ultimately the storms, you know, they still make the rules.
Also slightly confusing to me, and I'll say that, where I was ready to dive in, and then I was like, I don't know if we dive into that.
It was like a carousel. It was really cool. Weird, and the whole mezzo just looked like it was on the ground. So I had never seen anything like that before.
We misjudged the storm's character. We misjudged its speed, and we misjudged its intensity.
Guys, have we heard from Bettis, anyone? Okay, I'd like to see if we can at least get contact with Mike Bettis.
Things do not always behave the way that things have done in the past.
Dr. Forbes, we do have meteorologist Mike Bettis on the phone. Hey, Mike, we were really worried about you there. How are you doing, and what's your situation right now?
Chris, kind of our worst nightmare. We were hit by the tornado.
I call the situation in El Reno extremely unusual circumstances, because usually as a tornado makes a left turn, it's in its weakening stage and shrinking stage. In this case, it made a left turn as it intensified, as it expanded.
And I was saying, yeah, you know, that's a damaging RFD circulation in there, but, you know, it's probably just RFD. And we didn't realize we had, you know, basically a 2-mile-wide tornado immediately on our heels.
Like, where's this wind field coming from, you know? And I look out the window and there's, you know, all dirt field except like a house here, a house there. So there's nothing to kick up but dirt, but it's just like chaos is beginning.
The driver of the truck was letting us, the rest of us, know that he felt the truck beginning to lift off the ground.
You okay? Yeah! You're fine! Don't move! Get down!
So now it's like, we've got to get out of this, you know, but he couldn't get over 60.
Afterwards, we saw the wedge take shape. It came out of the rain. We could see the subvortices moving around the edge at 100 miles an hour, which looked like normal sized tornadoes. And at that point, we were completely blown away and awestruck.
There were other chasers who were flying in every which direction.
Felt like forever, 30 seconds, 45 seconds, maybe as much as a minute, till we finally hit that west wind and then hit a traffic jam.
There's I-35, Gary. That is a parking lot. If this thing passes over I-35, it's just gonna be disastrous again.
Once the storm was now going through Oklahoma City and heading toward Moore, or whatever, and it was producing damage, and you had serious hype going on some of the local stations.
That's when it got really, really messy for us in terms of driving and traffic and dangerous, just numbers of people. I had never experienced anything like that before.
We were caught in the
bad inflow
exodus
and
after that.
Exodus things and trees down blocking escape routes, and it was really not a good experience at all. But we realized pretty quickly that we hadn't actually had that bad of an experience compared to others.
That's a Weather Channel vehicle?
Yeah.
Are they okay?
I don't know.
Sometime before midnight, I'm about to go to bed. I just posted my goodnight Facebook status update, and I get an email from Mike Nelson, who is a chief meteorologist at Channel 7 in Denver, who I worked with for many years. And all it said was, is it true what happened to Tim? About 1 or 2, Facebook started going crazy. So I started getting just flooded with, you know, what's going on? What's going on?
I toured some of the El Reno tornado vent damage like an hour or two before sunset on June 1st. And I saw a handful of overturned vehicles, like pickup trucks that had been rolled. And I saw that
little cobalt car that Tim had been in, not knowing it was his. Got an email from Brad Carter that said he'd like me to call him because one of our friends died in the tornado.
And then that Sunday morning I woke up and I had two of my bookers that work here and they kept calling me and I had missed like 8 calls, you know, for the 4 hours I was sleeping. They're like, you know, Tim Smeris, he's dead.
Well, it's been such a heavy weekend for everyone again here in Oklahoma. So many families and friends lost. And yes, like you said, now colleagues, 3 men who were all about the science.
If anyone understood and respected the power of nature, it was Tim Smeris, his son Paul, and their colleague Carl Jung. They were tracking the powerful EF3 tornado in El Reno Friday night. The area getting hammered by 165 mile per hour winds. Many of the storm chasers barely outrunning the twister, but Tim and his team did not survive. Tim was found seatbelted in his car, the others apparently pulled from the car by the tornado.
It didn't click with me at the time. Dania came around and she asked me, she's like, because I probably had something on my face or something, she goes, what's wrong? And I looked up to her, and I said to her, I said, Tim, Carl, and Paul were killed in that tornado. And when I said it, that's when it hit, and that's when I lost it.
And I was just so, like, it makes me upset now thinking about it, because the surrealness of the reality of that, of him going, it still doesn't make sense.
And then to find out what we narrowly escaped did happen to someone else. And even worse, it's somebody that you know two of them personally. And yeah, it's just a weird thing. And you know, it's chasing is weird since then.
I think the work that everybody did to try to piece together the situation was great, but the problem I was having was they were trying to make it a heroic thing. You know, they were trying to say he was deploying probes or doing this, and it was just he was in the wrong place at the wrong time. And I did not like that people were trying to make it more than what it was. I understand that you want to make a legacy for him, you know, make it so that his passing means something. And I think it does in a sense, just not in the manner of which people were trying to do with it.
I was hopeful that it would cause the storm chasing community to do a little soul searching and ask themselves if the risks that they were taking were really worth it. And unfortunately, the selection of YouTube tornado videos that I have seen from this year tells me no. I'm seeing some additional stupid behavior. I've seen people getting way too close, in my opinion, to destructive tornadoes. And unfortunately, I don't think that trend is going to go away.
And if I'm just goofing off, is it worth some of the risk, or what are the unintended consequences of just a few seemingly innocuous decisions? It kind of puts it in perspective, and it's a big, dangerous world out there, and you know, you don't have nearly as much control as you think you do.
I think the people that have those emotions and have that predisposition that enjoy it the way they enjoy it, I don't think the outside world is going to change that, because you know, they're like a time capsule of their type of chasing. You are yours, I am mine. These kids today, you know what, maybe in 20 years when the chasing is even weirder and different, they'll still do what they're doing today.
Yeah.
But, I mean, and that's partly what makes it great. I don't think I would like it as much looking at it from the outside if everybody was the same chaser.
What's in the past is in the past. You can't change the past. Keep moving forward and just keep marching. Our best days, both in storm chasing, weather community, and science, is still our best days are still ahead of us. Our best discoveries, because of dual pole and other technology coming about in the weather community globally, are still ahead of us.
I think it's fun to see people inspired, and a lot of people will think that, oh, there's too many chasers out there, it's ruined my hobby, but it's kind of a selfish, egotistical look at it too, because the more storm chasers that are out there now, and with thousands of chasers out there now, it's almost impossible for a tornado to go unseen and, more importantly, unreported.
And that's the one thing that I think is important for even new chasers starting today, who, as much as they try and using modern technology, when they miss a storm, the important thing is to learn from that. If you learn nothing, then it is in fact too bad.
So if you think about it, if there are more chasers out there and more traffic jams, yeah, it can be frustrating for some of us chasers that want to get to a storm, But overall, it's helping out in the warning process, and people are inspired about the sciences and about a cool field. And I think it's an honor to see all these people interested in what we do.
I always love storms, but man, I've seen so many dang tornadoes. I always love it. And who knows? I'm going to take a break from tornadoes. But that's the thing, tornado season creeps around, even though I get sick of it. I'm looking at SPC, I'm looking at the weather models again.
For me personally, I certainly am not as hardcore of a chaser as I used to be. I used to chase every single setup and go after every single day I thought might possibly produce a tornado. And as I've gotten older, I've gotten a little bit more selective about that, not just because I've got a few tornadoes under my belt and I'm not as desperate, but also just because I've gotten busy. You know, I have a PhD now, I have a research scientist position, I have a family. I cannot afford to chase every setup anymore.
There seems to be this reoccurring mindset that we're all crazy. And I understand why, because the media has a tendency to focus on the most dramatic, big shock. Get rid of the notion that we're crazy. Yeah, there are those that are a bit nutty, a bit irresponsible. The overwhelming majority are good people, and I don't see that changing. I think it's going to stay that way. I hope it stays that way.